Of grace continues on to teach us about reference to the type of teaching that a parent does to a child. A disciplined type of teaching. And that's something that we need to understand. You know, people a lot of times when they talk about grace, they teach grace, they seem to want to promote permissiveness. But whenever we look at the scriptures, a true understanding of grace doesn't promote permissiveness, but it actually disciplines the believer to live a certain way. And so our understanding of the grace revealed in Scripture is to have a disciplining effect in our life. Like children in training, as we grow in our understanding of the grace of God, it trains us to live a certain way. And that's important for us to understand. People throughout centuries have been trying to turn the grace of God into passivity, trying to promote submissiveness with it, when in fact, the Apostle Paul teaches us that grace has a disciplining effect in our lives. That the more I know of God, the more I know of His grace, and the more I know of His favor and His goodness towards me, that's not going to cause me to throw off my limits. That's going to cause me to draw the genuine limits that God places on me in order to live a life of grace. So if a person tells you that they believe in grace, but then you look at their lifestyle, and their lifestyle is without limits and standards, they don't know. But a person that says they understand grace and people look at their life and they live a life that is limited to God's grace. They live a life that is disciplined by the standards of righteousness outlined in the scriptures. Folks, that's not legalism. That's living. That's living. And so grace gives to us. Grace gives to us the structure that we need to live our life according to the will of God. But what's the first thing that grace teaches us? First of all, it teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldliness. Is that one of the things that you thought of whenever I asked you about what the life of grace looked like? The first thing you thought, that means you deny ungodliness and worldliness. But grace teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. What does the word deny mean? Deny means to say no. To say no. One of the most powerful words that you and I can use in our Christian walk is the word no. What was one of the first things, or what is the first thing, that we have to do to be a disciple of Jesus? Matthew 16:24, Jesus said that if anyone desires to follow me, he must first do what? Deny himself. Same word. He must learn to say no to himself. And so many Christians struggle in their walk, and we all experience this, where we just will not say, or sometimes cannot say no to the things that we should say no to. When was the last time you got yourself in a bind because you should have said no to something? And you feel guilty or something like that. Being approached by someone and they want to offer you to get involved in something and you know it's not for you and you know you don't want to do it, but you just can't say no to them because they're just annoying you. And you end up saying yes and then you think back, I wish I'd have just been up front and said no. Because see, whenever we fail to say no to the things that we should say no to, what it does is it clutters up our lives with all of those things that can keep us from living effectively in Christ Jesus. I can't follow after righteousness if I haven't said no to unrighteousness. Before we can say yes to anything, it has to be preceded by a no to what we're going to do. As the Apostle said in the book of Romans, chapter 14, abhor that which is evil, cleave to that which is good. We've got to do the hard part. We've got to abhor that which is evil. And you know, when you really abhor something, it drives you away to the opposite. it. We're giving strength to it. And it's going to become emboldened in our life. And it's going to grow stronger and stronger and stronger until we lose the capacity to say that. You know people like that? Are we a people like that? That we have things that we know we should say no to, but we keep indulging ourselves? Because we've surrendered the power to say that. You know, I hear people say, I just can't help myself. And I'll do it. Because the time when you could help yourself, you did. And you surrendered your control. So it's very important that we understand the power of the word no in living a life of grace. So a life of grace involves denying ungodliness and worldly love. Then it teaches us that we should live a certain way. Okay, we're saying no to this over here. Now we're going to go over here and we're going to live a certain way. We're going to live soberly, righteously, and godly. What does it mean to be sober? The word sober means to have a sound mind, to be prudent. Careful about one's conduct. To be circumspect. Discreetly, wise self-restraint in speech and behavior, circumspect. Really, I put a couple of definitions together to try to get a good grasp on the meaning of this word. But the part of this word, whenever I was studying this word and looking at its definition, one word that kept appearing over and over again, the word circumspect. Circum means around, like the circumference of a circle. Spec means spectacle, to look. It means to look around. You're looking around. You're aware of the danger in your environment. That's why he says, careful about one's conduct. We live in a very unfriendly world. This world is not our home, as we see. This world is against us. And there are dangers in this world. And we have to live with a healthy regard for the dangers that are out there and always have, as the old saying goes, our head on a stick. We're always prepared. We're all feeling reasonably comfortable with each other, but if I told you, there's a curve. You'd immediately come. You'd become a little more circumspect. You'd be aware of what's going on around you. You'd want to know, where am I? You'd have a sobriety about it. It makes you aware of your world and your surroundings. And again, that's why whenever you talk to people who are in sin, they didn't get there because one day they decided to go out and be a drunk. I won't be a drunk. No, they didn't. They got that way. And all the while they were getting that way, they were unaware. Because they were unaware of the danger and the pain that was going on around them. By being sober, we're careful about our conduct. We're careful about the people that we're in. We're careful about what we watch on TV. We're careful about the movies we go to. We're careful about what we read in magazines. We're careful, 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 careful. We're looking in every situation for the danger. You know, I know kids are frustrated with parents because parents always see the danger in everything. A lot of times the kids don't see the danger. But that's the way we're supposed to be as parents. They didn't know and understand the danger. And it's obviously a connection. Like up here on this point, I'm real comfortable coming right here and walking to this man because I told you. It's really not any danger. You take this same platform and elevate it about a hundred feet. I'm not going to be standing here in my toes. Because I sense danger. I sense danger. And so that's going to make me act. If you were sitting there and I was up 100 feet and I walked right here, I come right here like this. Everybody's just sitting here. And I'm up 100 feet and I come right here. You're good. We have to understand the dangers that are in our lives. We have to understand what's out there. We have to understand what's around us. That's a life of grace. We're to live soberly. We're to live righteously, fulfilling all claims that are right and becoming, just as it should be. Fulfilling all claims, all standards, the rule of life. So I'm going to watch for the dangers, and I'm going to live according to the standards. A life of grace doesn't teach us that we don't have standards. It helps us to see and understand and appreciate the standards we have. Make your conscience new and fresh.